archaeology, our study is essentially based on a skeleton from which we try to reach the corpse and how he was buried. In the context of a PhD entitled Decay of the Corpse and Funeral Practices of the Population of the Past, Comparison between Forensic and Archaeological Data, I had the opportunity to make observation on corpse undergoing decomposition and thus approach the question of the restitution of burial practices from the corpse to the skeleton, and thus study the decomposition process and its role in the constitution of the archaeological image. So I studied 50 burials from the 19th and 20th century from two sites, Châtelet in Belgium, with 15 burials realized between 1870 and 1963, and 35 individuals from exhumation from a contemporary Swiss cemetery, CSC. In both cases, I worked on the photographic documentation produced during the exhumation. For Châtelet, several general and detailed photographs were taken, but at CSC, we had only one general and non-zenithoid photograph of the burial. At CSC, the burial are more recent, and they are realized between 1985 and 1987. In Châtelet, the individuals are buried in zinc coffin, which are placed in cellar in 14 cases, and the last one is buried in the ground at the depth of 2 meters in the clay soil. The deceased are buried dressed, and those devices are sometimes remarkably well preserved, such as a man dressed in a suit here on your left, and a woman dressed in a yellow wool shawl and wrapped in a blanket on your right. At CSC, the individuals are also buried in zinc coffins, most of which are complete with synthetic waterproofing clothes, like this, installed inside the casket to prevent the dispersion of the products of decomposition. All individuals are buried in the clay soil at the depth of 2 meters. The clothing is generally less well preserved than in Châtelet. However, in some cases, identification was possible. Like, for example, on your left, a man buried in a religious habit, and on the right, a subject dressed in a shirt that is still very well preserved. You can see the buttons of the shirt, and we have a bed of a rosary. Is that the man? Beyond a good theoretical knowledge of the decomposition process, I made systematic and detailed observations of all anatomical segments. In order to understand and characterize the evolution of the decomposition in context of a burial, and particularly in a zinc coffin. From an archaeological perspective, I have also paid particular attention to the logic of joint dislocation in order to provide additional data to those already acquired, which remain mainly based on archaeological examples. Finally, I studied 50 archaeological burials, mainly from the medieval and modern period, to evaluate how those information from a recent burial can be applied in archaeological context. Decomposition is a variable phenomenon that can result in the disappearance of soft tissues, the putrefaction, or the conservation over a more or less long period of soft tissue, which is the mummification and saponification, which are transformations of the corpse. Those evolutions are not necessarily independent of each other and can be perfectly in tune with each other. However, in our archaeological reasoning, in the absence of our organic remains, there is very little attention paid to mummification or saponification. In more detail, our observations reveal that putrefaction in a casket results in the liquefaction of soft tissues that are attracted to the bottom of the casket. However, it's not an homogeneous process and is closely related to the arrangement of soft tissue around the bones. For example, the tibia, which is on the anterior and medial position of the leg, encourage earlier exposure than the femur, which is covered by a greater quantity of soft tissues. As a result, soft tissue degradation and bone exposure doesn't occur in the same way in different anatomical segments. In addition, the accumulation of products, of decomposition products, particularly in the pelvis, which naturally forms a bowl, can allow the preservation of small bones or objects such as beds of rosary, for example. Archaeologically, this hypothesis could have been considered in different cases, such as here, for example, where the bones of the right hand, left hand, sorry. I confuse sometimes. Normally, they would have sit downstream. Their conservation, despite the initial context of empty space, is probably related to the accumulation of decomposition produce. But we'll see that it's a little bit more complicated, in fact. The recognition of mummification on corpses led me to ask the question of its restitution in an archaeological context. As the example shows, the wrist and the hand, which are known to be labile connections, have remained connected despite the displacement of this block toward the elbow. This phenomenon is most likely related to a temporary mummification of the hand. The member, elevated in the front of the abdomen, slipped toward the elbow, probably guided by a sleeve. Our observations could thus confirm the phenomenon of dislocation in paradoxical order by Jean Moret and Pascal Sellier. On the other hand, we were unable to identify osteoarchaeological arguments that would allow to propose a saponification hypothesis in archaeological context. Nevertheless, the discovery of white crusty residues, which is actually dry adipose, led me to propose this hypothesis, in particular for this case. Closing is also a factor not to be neglected, because it creates specific spaces, especially at the limb level, and can therefore contribute to differential degradation. By participating in the absorption and the absorption of liquids, clothing can promote mummification, as in this case, for example, the socks that play a major role in the drying of soft tissue. In archaeological context, closing, the recognition of constraint effect from the shoulder to the pelvis for these individuals, shows here a very narrow and persistent habit or wrapping, or both of them, until the skeletization of the deceased, since it impacts on the final arrangement of bones. On the left, the preservation of food connection, despite decomposition into empty space, is also a relevant argument for considering the presence of shoes. However, as shown by the right foot, we have small dislocation that can occur, particularly when the dorsal part of the foot comes up against the shoes. Frequently, it may be more difficult. Let's play with this example. As we suppose for the left hand, the preservation of the small bones on the hip bones can be linked to the produce of decomposition. But what about his right hand? As the example from the Gemrich collection shows, when the hands are unclothing, it can help, the connection can be preserved, even if in a coffin, and so in empty spaces. So for this archaeological example, if we initially consider an impact of decay process in the preservation of the connection for the left hand, we have also take in account the presence of clothing, even if we cannot distinguish the exact role of each parameter. The repetitiveness of the observations made, the consideration of the variability of the decomposition process, show that joint dislocation is a variable phenomenon that is closely related to the position of the deceased, the manner in which he is buried, and therefore the manner he decomposes. Here, for example, we know that the left hand is completely dislocated in the first case, while in the second case, the cover wrapped around the head, which allows the connection to be preserved in spite of a decomposition into an empty space. The various observations made during this exhumation provide information on the liability and the persistence of certain connections. I would like to illustrate this point with the example of the forearm and the wrist. At the wrist and the forearm, observation revealed that the joint between the radius and the ulna is more labile at the distal end than at the proximal joint. This hypothesis is supported by the distribution of the ligaments. the object code is more persistent in the third, in the proximal third on the one hand, and on the other hand, the annular ligament on the proximal extremity of the radius is also particularly a strong ligament. It's from a biomechanical point of view, but it's not the only argument, I think. For the wrist, the relationship between the cup and the radius is more persistent than with the ulna. Again, anatomically, this hypothesis is supported by a larger articular surface at the radius, the presence of the articular capsule, and more a more homogeneous distribution of ligaments. On the other hand, the ulna is somehow grafted into the wrist, which probably contributes to the stability of this connection with respect to the radius. In conclusion, the study of exhumation of recent graves and thus observations made on decomposing corpses provides a reliable and relevant support to overcome the impossibility of carrying out experiments on human bodies. My work thus highlights that this type of approach, and on a larger scale, the study of decomposition corpses, is probably the best way to understand the logic of joint dislocation and thus advance our reasoning in the reconstruction of funeral practices of past populations. Thank you.